Yeah, so I'm Mateusz. I'm the part of the Google Developer Expert program on Android. And I'm also coding Android apps at the company called IG, and I co-organize the GDG Krakow meetup. So in case you are participating in some like GDG meetups, you probably know me somehow. Did you take part in our Nexus 5X competition? Did you like connected to the service? Actually, there are like plenty of people who took part, and like in this submission solution field, they are saying, "Oh, you didn't use ProGuard. It's so easy." Yeah, that was the goal actually. So I'm glad that many people actually figured out that coding is maybe not the best and the fastest and the easiest solution out there. But no worries. There is also like a secondary prize, like the Android Studio debugging plugin compatible with the last version of the Android Studio. Replacement for your tests and yeah, stuff like that. So basically I will talk about Android Doze and App Standby features and whether they're our friends as for developers or the enemies. Because for a majority of time, like before the Android 6.0, Android was a platform that did let developers do almost like everything. We had like background services, we had like wake clocks and sync adapters that could like run all the time, taking our batteries from this level to this level in just a matter of hours. So it's almost 5 p.m., right? So I assume that most of you charge your phone overnight. So who has a battery over, raise your hand if your battery is over 30%. 30%, okay, 50? 70? More than 70? Ugh, damn Nokia 3310 users. Okay. So, well, it's not solving like all the problems. So yeah, Marshmallow changes that. By introducing the App Standby and Doze, but there were some comments after the Google I/O when both features were introduced, that this is not a good news for Android developers. So let's talk about that. Doze and App Standby. App Standby is basically something like a per app Doze. So in case your user like or you installed the application on your phone and you never use it really, which is probably like a 60% of the apps I have on my phone, and Android basically recognizes such applications and silently make them silent. So it's putting them in something called like the App Standby. So this application has a limited access to the device resources. So is not draining the user battery as it could possibly do in the past. So what does it mean for the app or for the device to be dosed? Sync adapters will not work. Job schedulers will not work when the application is in DOS. You have no way to acquire wake clocks, and your alarm manager code is probably not working. In case you didn't like bump your target SDK to 23. So that's how DOS works. Here we are seeing the situation that the user uses the device somehow. For example, is unlocking in every single 5 minutes or just moving with it. And then the user puts the device on the table. And let's say it takes like 1 hour here. And then after 1 hour of such inactivity, we are getting to the DOS mode, right? And then we got the maintenance windows that are happening time to time. The actually time differences are like incrementally this is like the incremental backoff, right? So each DOS period is a bigger than the previous one. So this is what the documentation says. This is what the ADB logcat says when you try to test those and you leave your phone for multiple hours on the table. You sacrifice your device just to make the slide. So basically, yeah, that was horrible, not checking my Twitter stream for 6 hours. Well, so basically the first dose period happens after 1 hour on device inactivity. We'll define later what does it mean that device is inactive. The second one after 2 hours, then after four, and then after six. I wouldn't assume the difference can be bigger than 6 hours. It's not anywhere in the documentation. It's my own research. I also confirm it with the research of some other guys who are speaking on this topic. It might change in the future. I wouldn't really rely on this behavior. And the maintenance window is typically 5 minutes. I read some research on the internet that for some people it was 10 minutes. I couldn't reproduce that. For me, it was always like something around the 5 minutes to fully access the internet connection and do the just the maintenance work while the device is in doze mode. And the situation is quite different for the app standby. So that's the one of the differences between the between being dozed as the whole system and being an inactive app, so getting into the app standby bucket. So in case your application is in an app standby, you will have a one maintenance window per 24 hours, which you shouldn't really care about because those users are not using your app. So it shouldn't it shouldn't be a problem if you are an app developer, unless it's a Trojan or yeah, or something. What does it mean that the device is active? So for example, the foreground service is running. The foreground service is a service that exposes the notification. So for example, when you are playing some music on the Spotify, that's the foreground service playing back your music. User is moving, important part with the phone in the pocket or anywhere else. So in case you are not touching your device, you are not unlocking it, but you are keeping it in the pocket and walking for a couple of hours, it won't get dosed. It will be still marked as active. And of course, when the device is charging. There was many people complaining about the feature that it will kill some kind of the applications like the sleep tracker. Not necessarily, because as I said at the beginning, majority of people probably charge the phone overnight. So you can rely on your Android device that if it's plugged to the electricity, it will not get dosed. You can actually listen on the events that are emitted in the system when the state of those is changing. There are actually couple of the different states between the full idle, so the fully dose, and the active. So you will receive the multiple string types within the broadcast receiver if you are setting the broadcast receiver for that action. Important thing, that's also a case for a couple of other actions that in broadcast receivers. This broadcast receiver will not work when defined in the manifest. You need to define it within the code. And bind it strictly to the context. The same is, for example, for the battery progress broadcast receiver, probably. Workaround, so the thing we all developers love. So we can use Alarm Manager, for example, but not in a way we used it in the past. So there are two different new methods added in the API level 23. That allows you to run your code as it would run on, for example, the lollipop. So in case you are using set and allow, then there is the alternative method called set and allow y idle and set exact and allow y idle, which means that your alarm will be triggered even if the device is in doze mode. And You will be given 10 seconds to obtain the wake locks you need, the partial wake locks you need, and do the work. In case it takes more than 10 seconds, no matter if it's a service or you are doing it on the main thread, it's just 10 seconds. Otherwise, Android will possibly kill your application. And you may receive also 15 minutes ban. So it's not like they introduced Doze and then introduced the workarounds within the API, so you can just bump your methods to the new version and completely ignore the system. Actually, in case you are abusing simply the alarm manager, you will be able to send one alarm in 15 minutes. Also, there is some kind of the throttling for a normal alarm manager, and it was there in the past, but it was about 1 minute, and it might happen if you were abusing the alarm manager. And the important part is that the fact that your code will be triggered from the alarm manager doesn't necessarily mean that you will get the internet connection. That's a very important part. So when to use it? So, for example, let's say that you are a Google Calendar application developer, and you can actually, based on the data in the database, for example, you can actually schedule the calendar notifications based on the data that you already stored in online. For example, the offline notifications for calendar or the alarm app can use this kind of mechanism with success. GCM, high priority messages, is the other way of workarounding the Doze and app standby. So this is the payload we know already for years since the GCM was introduced. And there is a new field called priority, and there are two possible values for this priority field. One is normal, which is default, and the second is high. So in case you are sending the priority high, your application would possibly receive it and wake up. And yeah, it's intended to use in the instant messaging applications, for example, because imagine that there is some very important message to be delivered. So no matter if you are moving with your phone or your phone is lying on the table, you would probably like to see the notification and hear the sound that the new message just came. And we need to be strict about it. Let's not abuse the high priority GCM messages. So for example, if it's just a ping to synchronize your device, and it doesn't necessarily mean any like the significant information to the user, like the intrusive notification, don't kill the user battery using it. For example, the voice over IP. I was actually wondering how Skype or some other clients will work on the new Android. They actually don't right now very well. But there is a variant that can use the GCM high priority messages in order to accept such calls. So imagine whenever you are getting a call, you are sending the high priority message to wake your device up with some like kind of the token or the incoming call identifier. And then you can come back to the server to, for example, open the stream of the call or something. But that's what the documentation says and many blog posts says. They say exactly what I told you now and exactly what I told last week on DevFest in Warsaw when I was giving this presentation. But it's all lies. It doesn't work. It doesn't work, actually. I tried, and like many others tried. My fellow Android developers tried. And you are actually receiving the GCM message on your phone. But if you try, for example, to perform some network request after it or just invoke the service, you simply can't. And there is already a bug submitted for that. Hopefully this will be fixed. This will be fixed in the future, because it's not working as it was described during the Google I.O. and later on in the multiple blog posts, also those submitted by Google. The biggest gunfire as workaround is like ignoring totally battery optimizations. So, as you probably know, Marshmallow together with the App Standby and Doze comes with the nice shiny setting inside of your settings to ignore battery optimizations. And you can actually turn the screen that displays this shiny checkbox to the user using that intent. So this is actually show the list of the applications that are whitelisted for a Doze and App Standby. And this one will actually show the dialogue to the user to explicitly ask the user whether the application X can disable the battery optimizations. Important thing, in order to invoke that code, you need to have this permission. And ignore it and ask the user for that only in case the core functionality of your app will be broken otherwise. Because otherwise your application will get banned from the Google Play. First it will be First they will block, and then they will like delete it all over with your comments and ratings. This actually happened to many apps, and some of those apps had like over like a couple of million downloads. So you really need to be very careful about asking for this feature, because as you already know from the competition of Nexus 5 for the Nexus 5X, it's really easy to determine that you are using this constant in your code. So Google is actually checking the apps that are landing in the Google Play for that. So in case you are just doing it because of no reason, because for example you don't want to code something in the other way using the cost of the user's battery, you might get banned. And the important part is that it's Google to define the core functionality of your app, right? So they might say that you are not obligated to use that feature, and they will not discuss with that. So be very careful about this piece of code and this piece of code. So it's very easy to test your application both against Doze and App Standby. There are actually AB shell commands. This one is important because you actually need to, because if you are connected to your computer, just to get the logcat, for example, or do any ADB shell commands, it's charging, right? So you need to disable the charging of your phone, and then do the multiple steps. As I said before, there are like a couple of different stages that your device is entering before it actually gets the fully Doze. So this step needs to be performed like five or six times in a row in a short period of time in order to get to Doze. And this is the case of disabling and enabling App Standby. So as I said, it's per app, so obviously you will need to specify the package of the application in order to do that. Well, I would like to have something like that for my children so I can do the one ADB command and they are falling asleep. Like, that would be super cool. So Doze helps you write better apps, right? It helps you by requiring some things, but it's still helping developers writing better apps. So in most of the cases, there are good apps and there are bad apps. If your application is good, Doze and App Standby are not affecting your application in like any meaningful way. And in most of the cases, it breaks your app. You should probably rethink your architecture anyway, But there are some cases when the are really not helping, right? When you can use those workarounds. They are intended for such applications. They are not intended for lazy developers who don't want to code. They are intended for some really thoughtful use cases that need to use such workarounds. So, well,
okay, so
yeah.